okay, I will join my voice to thank Gladys for this beautiful conference and for the creativity that emanates from all of you, from all of us. So that's really very stimulating. So I'm glad to be here. Merci, Gladys. Okay, I'm going to tell you at the beginning things that you already know, I believe, but it's not never a bad idea to repeat certain things, you know. I used to have a teacher who used to say, le principe de l'éducation étant la répétition. Je vais vous dire pour la énième fois que... Okay, so African women came to writing rather late. Their first sporadic writing were published in the 1960s and in the form of poetry. They were then followed by autobiographies in the mid-1970s, but we can say that the corpus of African women writing came in the 1970s and continued in the 1980s. It blossomed at this time, never to stop again. Okay, so when the first women were writing about la condition féminine, the women's condition, then the scope of their literary production became larger and their topics more and more varied to encompass other social issues as well as political questions, even as they, put the women at the center of their preoccupation in a feminine-centric perspective. The poems that we have chosen to analyze today are an example of that expansion. In 2009, noting that there were very little poetry available for teaching and for the readership at large, I am brought back upon editing an anthology of African women's poetry, a work that took about 10 years for different reasons that I may talk to you about at the end. And Janice Mays translated the poems, thus making the book a bilingual work in order to reach a wider audience. It is interesting to note that in this anthology, we count four poems on Gorée. That island off the coast of Senegal, almost opposite to the capital city, Dakar. Gorée was the last piece of land of West Africa that the Africans who were forcibly snatched from the shores of the continent for the New World saw before the Middle Passage, which was to transform them into slaves. It is said that an estimated 20 million Africans passed through the island between the mid-1500s and the mid-1800s. When one visits Gorée and sees the vestiges of where human beings were held in cramped warehouses and sees the shackles that held them in place in a space that was ironically called la maison des esclaves, the house of the slaves, one can really see how Gorée can be viewed as both a site of memory. In fact, the island is called l'île de la mémoire, the island of memory, and also the island of a site of trauma. It is important to note that the island of Gorée has been a source of painful inspiration for many writers in Francophone Africa, from Pierre Loti to Léopold Sédar Senghor and beyond. However, while slavery has been a trauma constitutive of collective identity in the US, it has hardly been the case in Africa itself. Many African writers spoke of the trauma and the horror of the slave trade, but generally did so in relation to those who left the coasts of Africa. In the poems by women, we note a painful memory of the events that marked the history of Gorée, but also the beginning of an expression of trauma within Africa. In A Rain of Words, a bilingual anthology of women's poetry in Francophone Africa, we read the following poems, all on Gorée, or referring to the ill-fated island. You have then Île-Mère, Mother Island, by Sohna Benga from Senegal, Gorée Mon Île, Gorée My Island, by Tekla G. Benissan from Benin, Gorée Île Baobab, Gorée Baobab Island, by Tanela Boni from Côte d'Ivoire, Un Jour à Gorée, A Day in Gorée, by Fatou Gaïso, from Senegal, and Atlantique des Mille Traversées, Atlantic of the Southern Crossing, which I wrote, and you'll see. Okay, what we notice right away, and the anthology is just a selection of poems, is that the women speaking of Gorée come from different countries, and that Tekla Benissan's title is Gorée Mon Île, Gorée, my island. though Benissan comes from Benin, what we can infer from that variety of women's nationalities and for this appropriation of the island is that Gorée belongs to all of us. It is part of our painful collective history, and this is reinforced by certain titles, such as Sohna Benga's title, Île Mère, Mother Island. The trauma is infiltrating African consciousness, as seen in the last line of Sohna Benga's poems. And I'm going to read it in French because I prefer to read in the original language. Gorée, ma stoïque, ton souvenir me rappelle le calvaire de tant de générations perdues dans la braise de sang et de la haine, dans la braise du sang et de la haine, Gorée, Île-Mère, qui demeure le flambeau de ma propre destinée. And that's where you see the connection, qui demeure le flambeau de ma propre destinée. Now, Tekla Benissan's poem, Gorée, My Island, which she says should be accompanied by a kora, is a song, almost a dirge, which seeks to immortalize the memory of the atrocities that took place in Gorée. And here it is. Gorée Mon Île, that's the last poem, the last stanza, I think. Gorée Mon Île, voici aussi le chant du souvenir, with capital letters. Voici aussi le chant du souvenir pour calmer tes blessures, oublier les injures. Écoute le chant du souvenir, Gorée Mon Île, choisie parmi les îles. Okay. Choisie parmi les îles. Fatou Ndiaye-So, who writes poetry for children, reminds them in a didactic way of A Day in Gorée and starts with these words. Sais-tu mon fils? Do you know my son? And then she recounts the story of what happened in Gorée and calls to mind the resilience of those left. She then speaks of the blues, that music which is so typically African-American, and ends the poems with the idea of a link, a powerful link, in fact, a blood pact that should exist between the sisters and the brothers who left the continent and those who stayed. And here it is. Oh, pardon. Oh, qu'est-ce que j'ai fait de bon? Ah, it looks as if. Oh, here it is. Okay. Fatunga is so. And she says, et là-bas, au-delà des frontières, quand les blues remuent les entrailles de la nuit, c'est ton frère qui te rappelle le pacte du sang. Tanela Boni, who has a whole book of poetry called Gore il Baobab, she has a whole book called Gore il Baobab. The title recalls the strength that the baobab has and the deep rootedness that it is known for. When a strong, extraordinary person dies, don't we say in West Africa that a baobab has fallen? And I think it is in this context that she calls the island Il Baobab. In the anthology, we selected four excerpts that concentrate on the physicality of the description of the island, attempting to make it a real place, because everybody sees Gore as a symbol. Okay, so she's trying to make it a real place. So she speaks about, she evokes the steps of the crescent moon, the staircase. How many people went to Gore? Okay, just one, two, three, four, five. Okay, so when you go there, you know, you have the entrance and you have the steps like as a, you know, semi-moon. And so she speaks of those, if you go there, you really see the image. Okay, the steps of the crescent moon staircase. Then she speaks about the windows, but she called them the windows of silence. Then she speaks about the walls washed by the water of the sea. And again, the walls encrusted with stones that still recount the cries and prayers of the salt that carried hope. Gore is also the gate of the continent. Gore is called again Gore Baobab, crossroads with spreading roots. Okay, she makes it real. Almost as if, and she also evokes Joan Ndiaye, Joseph Ndiaye, who was the curator and the caretaker of the Maison des Esclaves, almost as if he were the last prisoner there, the one left to remember those who have gone. And unfortunately, he died in 2009, but he was really a very dynamic curator, telling the story in a lot of emotional ways. And once you heard Joan Ndiaye, you could not forget Gore because of the way. J'espère qu'il a préparé la relève. So all the poems attempt to imagine the feeling that we spoke a lot about feeling today, the feeling movement, right? So all the poems attempt to imagine the feeling, the terror, the confusion, the helplessness of the displaced Africans, the absolute strangeness of that unimaginable voyage to the end of the world, to nowhere, in fact, to a place they had no knowledge of, no connection with. Finally, too, the island is a symbol of Africa's lost history, the movement from enslavement to colonization, to forms of neo-colonialism, and the necessity of remembering and remembering as a way to now begin creating a new history. What is important is a sense of a historical continuity, of the steady movement from the slave trade to colonial conquest and rule to post-colonial continued exploitation. And that's what we have to be careful about. That's why we have to be vigilant, right? In a sense, the slave trade marks the beginning of Africa's domination by the West, the continent's historical eclipse. Okay, but when you have an eclipse, afterwards you have the you have the sun and the moon and so on. So just consider it as an eclipse. That's what is memorialized in Gorée, as well as the African people lost in their own history, society, and culture. People can be traumatized by their sense of being powerless, helpless, a condition the slave trade particularly represented, and a preview of the colonial situation. Indeed, in a contemporary context where African people are still in the process of recovering their own history, of trying to understand how the present is a consequence of the past, or finding a way to speak of that history in a critical and useful ways that can affect the present, it is necessary for writers to create powerful symbolic objects of memory for that purpose. Such an object is the island of Gorée, now both notorious and in a strange way sacred as a symbolic point of departure, the beginning of the great diaspora. We know that certainly that Gorée was not the only African port from which enslaved people were sent off to strange lands, what I call the end of the world. It may not even have been the most important or the most continuously in use over this century, but it is a place in which the memory of all those ports, all the meanings of the loss, the traumatic severance have been collected in a name and the commemoration of a small, otherwise negligible island. It is for that reason that the poems listed above all speak of memory, as you saw, of trauma, but also of loss and reconciliation. And now I would simply, in finishing, you know, the very short paper, to read you, oops, to read you my poem, and I just have the first stanza here.
Je crois que je peux faire ça.
Okay. Vous m'entendez?
Oui.
Alors, ça s'appelle Atlantique des mille traversées. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as vu des noirs, des milliers de noirs, quitter les rives de Gorée, de Ouida, d'Amina. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as vu des milliers de noirs, chers à tout faire, entassés dans le ventre cupide des bateaux négriers. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as entendu les murmures agonies et les sanglots au plus profond des flots. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as senti les tumultes de la mer et les tumultes de l'âme, tempêtes de terreur au fond des cœurs qui n'en savaient rien, qui n'en pouvaient même. Et là-bas, sur la terre autre, les affres de l'esclavage, brimades, fusillades, lynchages, mais aussi résistance, l'être noir debout, dans toute sa splendeur, dans toute sa fierté, mu par la passion du rythme, la survie folie du chant, les Negro Spirituals fendant des nuages du ciel, mu par le mythe du Flying African et par la réalité du retour. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as vu des milliers de noirs revenir sur la terre ancestrale. Du Bois, Wright, Baldwin, Malcolm X, Angela Davis, Alex Haley, Maya Angelou. Et bien d'autres encore, au nom ténébreux, mais au cœur lumineux, au sens gourmand d'écouter, de regarder, de humer, de palper, de goûter l'Afrique. Atlantique des mille traversées, tu as vu des milliers de noirs revenir sur la terre ancestrale, faisant honteusement mentir les portes du non-retour. Atlantique séparation, Atlantique humiliation, Atlantique ressentiment, mais aussi, mais toujours, Atlantique trait d'union, magnifique arc en mer jeté pour nous entre l'Afrique et les Amériques. Merci.